use. So oftentimes when you're trying to do that, the storm is totally be stripped away of any reality. So it's a work of fiction. But the people definitely are people that I know. The next one is called Danny Boy, and this is a true person, and I was 16. So this is a poem that was dedicated to his first friend I had to die, Danny Boy. I was not supposed to be weak for a man's touch. I watched how Mama craved that touch. Men raided her bed and she never seemed satisfied. And neither was I. Greedy. It was like I was trying to feed a hunger I didn't understand. Then the plague showed up like burning tar on my body. I lost my strength. It brought me to the floor. Had me praying for Grandmama's blonde hair and blue-eyed Jesus. He was nailed above her bed. He didn't know anything about me. Grandma said, "Men loving men is an abomination." She told the family I had cancer, a kind that chemo couldn't cure. I shriveled down to my son's clothes. Couldn't hold a glass of water or give my son a horseback ride. Rumors ran around town. Danny Boy got the virus. I come back home to Sugar Hill to die in my grandmama's house. Nobody visited. My brother slept in the tube shed, not even in his own bed, in the room we shared growing. And Danny wasn't gay. It was just how just dealing with AIDS and how AIDS has come back. This is one of my favorite ones called Missing My Pillow. I don't know why it's my favorite. Nothing about this particular poem is true except when Jack was my favorite. When Jack came back from Vietnam, there was no more pillow left in him. I couldn't find a comfortable place to sleep. It was like lying on a coffee table with sharp edges. Whiskey saturated the sheets and left a stench I couldn't wash away. He was always drunk. But I stayed married to him until the day he died. I was grateful Jack made it back from the war. But sometimes, I wish he had died when he was over there fighting. Okay. This one is called Highlight. Are any of you familiar with the highlight? No?
So the game was like it had like a long, like really long,
yeah.
Like wasn't you throwing against the wall?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's pretty dangerous, right?
Yeah.
And they wear helmets and stuff.
You've seen it before?
I've seen it before, yeah.
Okay. So that's a big thing where I live in South Florida. And actually, Zania, the small town that I'm from, has like a big arena where this particular sport is played. And it's played, you know, they gamble. It's like they go in and they bet on the teams, and it's a gambling thing. But it is the neatest thing to watch. If you ever seen it, as he explained, they have like this basket affixed to their arms, and the ball is going some, you know, like 100 miles per hour or something like that. And they're playing to see which team wins. And I think it's something in a Hispanic culture, I think it is. But my city that I'm from, that was a big place that people went. So this one is called Hana. A dream deferred makes the heart sick. But when it is fulfilled, it is like a tree of life. This is a Bible scripture that I found one day thumbing through Psalms looking for comfort. Grandmama said comfort could always be found in the scriptures. I found it held true for those of us who frequent Daniel Highlight. This was the place where the scripture happened on a daily basis. The Highlight was open year-round, and a mission was free to those old enough to gamble. And people didn't have to have any money either. We could go inside and sit in the black section. If someone won big, they'd share their winning with all of us. We only needed $2 for a bid. This gave us a chance to fulfill our own dreams. I mostly went for fun with my godmothers who were there trying to take their dreams off the layaway. I imagine a lot of people in Sugar Hill had down payment on dreams that they'll never be able to afford. The arena had seats that looked like they traveled all the way up to Daniel Watertown. Later, we'd all stand around the tires. Later, we'd all stand around the towers when one of the gamblers jumped after spending his entire paycheck. I was fascinated with the actual game itself. Hispanic men in tight pants running around a court with a basket fastened to their arms, throwing a ball traveling at 150 miles per hour. It was a break from the despair in our neighborhood. At least at Highline, we could daydream. This one is called Fat Legs, and this is pretty true. I have very fat, nice legs, and even when I was a little girl, people always remarked about them. Fat legs. The men said, "Girl, you got some fat legs. Come here." Three times they were saying in unison like cats crying in the rain without an umbrella. I was unprotected by the force of nature on my body. Puberty struck me like the downpour did the asphalt. It beat out a song that has played in my mind for 44 summers. I still remember the quarter-sized droplets on my forehead. Men with their dicks pressed against their pants, lusting at me. I was pork on a pig. They said, "Girl, come over here with those fat, pretty legs." You guys are looking so solemn. Are you shocked by the language? Yes? No? Some?
Not really. I'm reading all in my head.
So you kind of figured it would be a little... I'm going to read a couple of new things I'm working on. And not all my poetry is like that. But just as a person and my personality, I'm known for a person who keeps it real. And language is a way to do that, to see it. But again, sometimes people are shocked by my word choices.